very, very exciting. I'm very happy to have him here. And today he is going to be talking about a Duane Hanson's secretary, which is one of the sculptures that is in the current Reflect exhibit at the museum. And I believe we only have a week more of that exhibition, or that portion of
the 25th. Return.
Yes. So Tory will hopefully entice you to come in and take a look if you haven't already seen Greta. So please, Tory, you can take it away.
Okay. So I'm going to talk about Duane Hanson's secretary. My office, the textiles workroom, and the textiles vault are all adjacent to each other in the basement of the museum. So I'm kind of tucked away. I'm typically by myself in my small office. And for a few months, starting in December 2020, I had an office mate. And we, of course, maintained social distancing. Please let me introduce you to Greta Hanson. Greta was born on January 15th, 1972, in Manhattan, New York. Her father, Duane Elwood Hanson, was living in New York at the time, specifically Greenwich Village. Not much is known of her younger days or if she stayed in New York or moved to Florida with her father when he moved back there in 1973. In 1982, she began her career with the Foster Goldstrom Galleries, starting in Dallas, Texas. In 1984, she got an offer she couldn't refuse and moved to the San Francisco office and personally worked for a Mr. Craig. Foster Goldstrom had three locations, San Francisco, Dallas, and New York. I think that her career with Foster Goldstrom's included all three locations. I know that she was at both the Dallas and San Francisco locations, and I assume she was at New York. After all, she is a New Yorker. She eventually moved back to New York with the O.K. Harris Gallery, even working on a show there in 1984. And it was at the O.K. Harris Gallery where she caught the attention of people from Hawaii. In 1987, she moved to Honolulu and began working for the Persis Corporation as the personal secretary of Mr. Thurston Twigg Smith in his office at John House, located on the slopes of Makiki Heights. I hear from former staff there that she was always at his desk. After dealing with all the visitors to Twigg Smith, she went into private service with Don and Duncan McNaughton. It was through them that she became more familiar with the art museums in Honolulu and worked on an exhibition at the Contemporary Museum in 2009. She eventually left the service of the McNaughtons and moved permanently to the Honolulu Museum of Art in 2011. Some of you are thinking, you're crazy, Tory. What are you talking about? That's a sculpture. Well, the staff at the museum have dubbed Secretary by Duane Hanson, a cast polyester and fiberglass sculpture completed in 1972, polychromed in oil with found clothing and accessories, as Greta. In December 2020, to prepare this hyper-realistic sculpture for the Reflect Modern and Contemporary Highlights exhibition, she was examined in the vault, and the signs of aging were noted. A team consisting of Registrar Kyle Swartzlander, collections managers Mark Thomas and Kayla Annan, and I proceeded to perform some conservation work on her. She was moved into the textile workroom for the work. When we removed some of the components, specifically her steno pad, we found a lovely handwritten note in cursive folded and tucked inside. The note reads, March 7th, 1984. Dear Mr. Craig, I would like to thank you personally for making this purchase and inviting me back to San Francisco. Since my arrival in Texas, life has been rather hectic. At Foster Goldstrom Gallery, they kept me in a freezing cold office with far too much to do. Later, they put me in a box with a plastic bag over my head. I was thoroughly humiliated. Besides, they couldn't keep their hands off me. I know from experience I won't have this problem from the men in your city. See you soon. Love, Greta. That note started our quest to build the history of the secretary sculpture we now call Greta. Who was she? There were a few other pages of handwriting in her steno pad, but we couldn't decipher. Some of it was Greg or maybe some kind of Pittman. But how could we build a story of Greta? Now, secretary was cast from a real person. That's how Duane Hanson created his figures. But we have yet to discover who the real Greta was or the model. But there is some information on the sculpture. She has a creation date of 1972, and we know that Duane Hanson was in New York City at the time. Hanson was convinced by the art dealer Ivan Karp to move from Florida to New York, which he did from 1969 to 1973. We even know where he lived in Manhattan, on the corner of the Bowery and Bleecker Street, across the street from the famed CBGB nightclub. Now, the CBGB opened when Hanson left New York City. So for most of the time when he was there, it was a biker bar known as Hilly's on the Bowery. It was a rough area of the city. So let's say that Greta was born in New York City. Together with the letter, notes from the object file, and a few other archived documents we discovered online, like archived exhibit lists from galleries, recreated her history of Greta Hanson. But she needed to get ready for the big show. The conservation treatment of Greta included several components. After an inspection and determination of what needed to be done, she was very carefully undressed. Upon reflection, it may have seemed like a Dustin Hoffman in the 1967 film, The Graduate, but there were four of us in the room with Greta and all the lights were on. There was no funny business going on. So after we removed her blouse, we noted that the blouse's left seam was previously open and it appears that Greta had been sewn into it. As we had several hands to maneuver her about, we removed the blouse and skirt with opening up any of the clothing seams. Her blouse and skirt were sent to Honolulu-based textile conservator Linda He. Greta was quite fashionable for the 1970s. Her beige long-sleeved polyester knit blouse is by Devon. Her plaid A-line merino wool skirt is by Bimodel, both of English manufacture. Linda and technician Charmaine Wong vacuum and wet cleaned the two items, which did remove dust and debris and minimize the foxing. Kyle worked with the artist estate Gagosian Gallery so that we could replace a few of the items, specifically her hosiery and watch band. According to Jim DeYoung, senior conservator at the Milwaukee Museum of Art, when Hanson was alive, he was very involved with the owners of his sculpture regarding their care and maintenance. Hanson was eager to be involved and involve others to replace worn or missing objects. From his guidelines and work on other sculptures and with the support of the estate, we did replace two parts with suitable replacements. Greta was wearing what could be called thigh-high legs brand hosiery. They were quite faded and had a few runs. At first, I thought the runs might be the result of using previously worn hosiery. That might have been the case, but after taking a closer look at her legs, the runs in the stocking possibly resulted from the rough fiberglass surface of her legs. When we put the new stockings on, we used tissue paper as a barrier between the fiberglass surface and the new hosiery to minimize any runs in the stocking. But where does one find new vintage style stockings? There is a supplier. What Katie did is a UK-based company with stores in London and Los Angeles that manufactures and sells new versions of vintage lingerie and hosiery. Some of their hosiery, specifically the reinforced heel and toe stocking like the one we used on Greta, is made in Derbyshire, England, in one of only four in the world still operating fully fashioned stocking factories in the world. Greta now sports new hosiery from What Katie Did in seam-free reinforced heel and toe nylon, sized medium in their champagne color. Her wristwatch, specifically the watch band, looked in very poor condition, was extremely faded. The original is on the top, the replacement is on the bottom. After some research, I found it very interesting that her wristwatch was a toy wristwatch made by Esko, a West German manufacturer who started making toys after World War II. As a toy wristwatch designed for a small wrist of a child, she wore it on the last watch hole band. So a new replacement watch band was required from Watch Band Center. It's one piece, 10 millimeters wide and brown, and it's not easy to find a watch band that narrow. And it's a pretty close approximation to the original and is from the Watch Band Center in Orenburg, Germany. We worked on the shoes in-house. Both shoes were thoroughly dusted. The leather uppers were wiped with a cotton cloth and distilled water and were coated in a wax-based shoe polish. I think they looked pretty good after being polished while also looking used. During the process, I did notice some paint. So it's possible that these shoes were originally pink and painted black. The eyeglasses and pan were also cleaned in-house with tap water and Orvis detergent. And I think the glasses looked pretty good after washing. And we didn't do any polishing as any abrasives might change the outer layer of the clear plastic. And we wanted them to not look brand new, but just clean. The pen was disassembled and washed, and we noticed that the pen contains all the components, but they're mismatched. So the shell and the case match up, but the pen ink refill didn't match. So it's really hard to figure out how Greta wrote those notes in her memo pad. So after we assembled all the parts, she was dressed. So I'm going to show you a short video of Greta being dressed, and that was shot by our awesome photographer, Alex Singer.
Not on the back. Okay, now let's take up the phone and then we can put it down. Okay, tilt it forward. Okay. Set it down. That would explain why the back heel was bent on this. You tilt it forward, I'll fix her skirt. Or just pick her straight up. Pick her straight up. Okay. Yeah.
Great. All right, look at that. Almost a real girl again.
But I didn't even know she looks a lot cleaner.
So in the interest of longevity and preservation, we did restuff her brassiere, and it was reused archival tissue. The original stuffing was actually paper napkins and paper towels. You saw that we took her temporarily out of the workroom and gave her a blowout, like what she would have had at a salon, but using much gentler and blow dryers with no heat. And you saw Kayla cleaning her hair. Kayla is our expert, as she was trained and has experiences on large headpieces. She was actually trained to work on Nick Cave sound suits at the museum. I did note that Greta's wig was painted several colors, and it really gives the appearance of naturally graying hair. In the gallery, just before the exhibition opened, reinstalled her accessories and fixed her hair to match older photographs. And here she is in the gallery, all ready to take a memo. Now, I'm betting that some of you here now, and there are probably a few fans of the movie series Night at the Museum. We're at the Museum of Natural History. An Egyptian tablet allows the museum's figures to come to life at night. And that's this mysterious and magical event is known to the night guard. And who I hear has some pretty sweet flashlight moves. Now, our head of security, Mike Chalk, also has some pretty sweet flashlight moves. But you'll have to ask him if he's ever seen anything, because HOMA has an Egyptian tomb relief in the museum. I don't know if there's any magical powers associated with that, but you can see Greta on exhibit in Reflect Modern and Contemporary Highlights until July 25th this month during normal hours.
Can we ask questions now? I'm just curious. Yes,
absolutely.
Who originally owned Greta? And do we have photographs of her in her youth?
Well, we know who owned her prior to us. Before 1982, we don't know where she was. So there's about a 10-year gap. We don't have any records for who owned her, but she did move to the Goldstrom Galleries and then O.K. Harris Gallery in New York. And so for her first 10 years, we're not sure. But she probably is dressed the same way she is when she was created. And you notice in the notepad, there's a few pages of writing. And so those actually tied to exhibit. So at some further point down the line, somebody wrote a new note and then turned the page on the memo pad. So if you know anybody that can read shorthand, you know, I'll gladly forward the image and we can maybe translate them.
We were told in docent training that Twig's secretary wrote the shorthand. So it has some reference to Hawai'i.
Yeah, there's a couple of dates, but there's an earlier one. So that might date to a different time. But I did hear that was one because she was his secretary. I mean, there are many stories of staff going into the office and saying, oh, excuse me, I'm sorry, she's not moving, or who's that lady in there? She doesn't say anything when I go in. Yeah.
Yeah, apparently as a joke, or, you know, he had her in his office for a long time.
Yeah.
Extra secretary.
How long did the whole process, Tory, take from you guys taking her out of the vault or whatever, and renewing her clothes and finding the nylons? That's quite a chore.
That work took just over about 3 months. So it was divided up over time. I know that the wet cleaning took about 2 weeks. The textile conservator did that. And, you know, so she was undressed for a while in my office. Okay. And I'll be honest, when all her clothing is on, she is very realistic. And so you have to take that second glance. But when the clothes came off, the realism stops a little past the clothes. So, you know, I actually was a little more comfortable when she just had her undergarments on. And I was like, oh, because I could see the fiberglass. And I said, oh, that's not a real person. But, you know, we did the work in stages. And so just to dress her, that was about two sittings to get the garments on and then the accessories on. But it really did take four of us to manipulate her because her hands are set. And like I said, we noticed seams in the blouse. So Duane Hanson probably opened up the seam, draped it on her and stitched her back in. But we didn't know that taking it off, but we had enough people to physically lift her up into space and then take the clothing off.
Well, did you do anything with her face?
We just dusted the rest of her. It is resin, so it's polyester and resin, fiberglass and paint, and the surface is in good condition. So we just did a dusting, but we didn't, it was basically the soft parts that we did work on.
Okay.
Okay. Is the chair original?
Yes, the chair. She's actually molded into the chair. And so when we did work on it, we actually made, if you saw, foam cradles so that she could be in the same orientation, but that chair is original.
Could you talk a little bit more about the process of how she was cast, and are these human castings a primary art product of Hanson's?
So I'm not a Duane Hanson expert, but I do know that he did cast from life. And I did see, when I was doing some research, I did see some reports where the models would actually go to the gallery and take a picture next to the sculpture of them. And what the sculpture depicts is not necessarily the model. He picked the model on an archetype or a look. And I know that some of his later works, like I think there's a cheerleader and a swimmer, those are actually Duane Hanson's children. He cast his children. So I think he might have just found somebody he liked or an interesting look, and he thought I could interpret that in a way. And he did cast them in segments, do plaster casting, and then cast them in resin.
What other museums have some of his works?
The Smithsonian, the Met, and I believe LACMA. We did actually loan a secretary for a retrospective traveling exhibition maybe a little over 10 years ago, but she has been loaned before. But this is the first time that we know that she's had conservation work done on her. Her blouse was pretty foxy, and I'll say foxy in the 70s, which is the discoloring of textiles.
Oh, can you say in terms of his span of work, time frame wise, where Greta falls within all of his works?
It's kind of early. So the late 60s, he actually started doing tableaus, and they were quite moving. Like one, I would say two of his late 60s works, one was a motorcycle accident and the other one was an abortion. So he crafted several figures to create a tableau scene of something that was very striking. And then in the 70s, he started to do single and dual figures that just kind of melded into the background. And so he was trying to create like art that didn't have a barrier. Of course, we do put a barrier so you don't interact with it and cause any damage, but you know, they would be sitting in the gallery. There's one of my favorites by him as a security guard, and it'd be in a museum and people would think that's the security guard. He's just like stand propped up against the wall. So this is actually one of his, I would say his early second wave. So from the tableau is his first period, and the second period would be the archetypes.
I had a question. During, you know, conservation work on sculptures like these, where and when do you decide that like the watch needs to be swapped out? Or like, how do you do the research on all of that, you know, or deciding like, oh, it's, you know, 50 years or 60 years from now, do you think the blouse and the skirt will need to be changed? And how, I guess, that thought process would go.
Well, the good thing about these sculptures is that there are instructions. I mean, like I said, Hanson actually had a supply. He went to the thrift stores and he had a supply of things in his studio. So when the institution said, oh, security guard number two is missing the pen in his pocket or somebody stole the pipe, he would just mail something to them to replace them. Even wigs, he had wigs and clothes. He just had the supply of items. And so because of that, of what was done previously, we've kind of followed that. And we did get permission from the Gagosian, the state, to replace these parts. And so you want it to look used, but not necessarily new. And so we did try looking for, a replacement blouse, but to find a specific type of early 1970s polyester blouse with the wide collar. And, you know, a lot of them will have the pussy bow or the lied lapels. But I was thinking it needed to be a button front so that we could put it on her. We couldn't put on a pullover shirt with her. So yeah, there's a couple of requirements. And knowing that Hanson's directive would be to replace, and actually one of the conservators at the Milwaukee Art Museum, a couple of the staff just hit the thrift stores and found a few replacement parts and put them on. And so, you know, it's nice that I could replace the hosiery with something new, not necessarily something period, because it may not last as long. And so we tried to clean, and the clothes came out pretty well because her blouse is polyester. 1970s polyester is very, very durable. Like I said, it just had a little bit of foxing and dust, so that was cleaned. And her skirt was actually wool, merino wool. And they're quite durable. So, you know, you just saw, I just had to tack on the closure in the back, and that was it. So they were cleaned and we put them back on. But in the future, at some point, they may have to be replaced. And so keep your eye out on early 1970s women's wear, size medium, small.
So for storage purposes then, are the protocol, the timeline protocols then based on the material versus the fiberglass that her body is made out of? I mean, how, you know, you talk about fabrics, you know, the 6 months in and then 5 years, is that the same?
That is a good question, because she's not considered a textile, she's considered a sculpture, but the curator of textiles is took over the work. That is a good question. And you know, textiles do have that viewing window. But because we have the option to replace, I think it would be okay to have her out for a while. And it would be good when she's stored, that she should be shrouded when she's stored, just to keep the dust and the light off her. But, you know, because the polyester is very stable, her wig, I mean, well, actually, it's punched in so that the hair is actually not just a wig, it's actually punched into the material, like you would do making a wig instead of actually knitting a wig. She's quite stable, and you know, we would just have to dust her and clean her, and you know, maybe vacuum her once in a while. But no, if anything does go wrong, we could just replace the parts.
Is it human hair?
I think it's synthetic when we were cleaning it, and it is sprayed because it's I thought it was quite dusty, but it's actually spray painted in a couple of layers. There's like a little bit of brown, a little bit of white, and a little bit of gray to give this very natural look. But it's actually, I think, a synthetic wig that was cut up and then hairs were punched in to the fiberglass. Yeah.
Were the clothing, the brands of the blouse and the skirt familiar to you? I know you're pretty
not too much.
Learned in all the brands.
Yeah, well, Devon is still around. So I actually did look up, they're both British clothing lines. And okay. My model is kind of the groovy, you know, they made mini skirts, but Devon is still around. Yeah. It's just, you know, tracking down those clothes. But yeah, she was quite stylish. And I would say the clothes are probably from the artist and not the model, because they're all a little loose because you have to get them on, so they're not exactly fitted. Yeah, even her brassiere, because we did stuff it, I didn't want to touch it because it's elastic and it was actually cut and then pinned together. And so, you know, it's better not to touch the elastic, because once the elastic shatters and then we can't replace it. Yeah.
Interesting.
Is she wearing perfume?
Oh, that would be a really good for the environmental insulation. And we did talk about that. How do we put a barrier up? Would we put a rug or a desk? They just went with the cable. But, you know, if we made an environment, maybe not perfume, but maybe the smell of coffee or cigarettes.
You need eau de Aquanet.
Aquanet, yes. That would be good.
So this, her situation very difficult to show her anywhere else. I mean, she would not travel.
She has traveled. She had, yeah, they do travel. They're created very specifically, but no, yeah, Hanson's work do travel. Yeah. The body is very stable. I mean, it is, we took a little peek inside because there are cavities and opening it. Yeah, it's just, it's very thick resin on fiberglass. Very, very durable, but it's, yeah, the clothing is the more delicate part. But yeah, she could travel, just crated.
How much does she weigh?
Oh.
Because three of you could pick her up pretty easily, it looks like.
Yeah, she's, I think, I'm going to guess it's been, without her chair, maybe 40 pounds. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Does she have an appraised value?
I don't know. I do know that if she traveled, she did have a valuation. I'd have to ask the registrar what the value is. I don't know that information. But I do know that some are still available for sale. They are done in series, and so you know there are a handful out in public and private hands that are available for purchase, and some of them are very interesting, and some of them are very engineered well. Like there's one of a majorette. A band leader. So she's like in her sequin tights and she's standing on one leg. So just the engineering alone, how do you put that much weight and in the early 70s and then to dress it to be somebody standing on one leg. And then he actually has some sunbathers and tourists, which have to be more realistic because they're only wearing their, shorts or bikini. So there's much more painting involved.
But when you say series, so she does not have a duplicate.
No. I mean more like groupings. Like he would do like a group of people at one time. Yeah, they're not series. They're all one. They're one of a kind. Yeah.
Isn't the security guard in St. Louis? I've seen it, and I'm trying to remember which museum.
I don't know about St. Louis. I know there's one in Milwaukee, because that's actually the conservator that whose report we drew off of, and there were two over there. And I think they had an exhibition as well. Yeah.
But I remember the security guard really looked like a security guard, and I was going to go up and ask him a question. And I'm like, oh, this is not real.
I remember seeing the two tourists, and they were actually, I think, on loan for an exhibition a long time ago. And they were just, you know, one's in a Hawaiian shirt and shorts, another lady in a big visor, and they're sitting on a bench in the middle of the gallery. And there was no barrier, so it looked like you could just sit down next to them, but very realistic. I mean, Patricia, did you ask the security guard any questions?
Almost.
They did an exhibition a few years back at the Asian Art Museum in San Francisco. And as a tribute to Ai Weiwei, they created a form of a man in a black suit, completely dressed, shoes, everything, face down on the gallery floor in a corner with no stanchions, nothing around it. And it wasn't the first place you would walk into. And so you would have these people rushing to the guards and say, oh, I think somebody needs help. But you couldn't tell right away because it was face down and it was just prone. Mm-hmm. It certainly is an amazing thing. Do you have an idea when that kind of casting of human-like figures, when did it even start?
Well, I mean, we've had automatons and life-size figures. I mean, we go back, you know, centuries. And so it was an art form of dressing mannequins or realistic figures. That goes back a few centuries. But as far as having one cause quite a stir, that's a little more recent to cause a stronger reaction than entertainment.
Tory, if you were to make a figure, what theme would you like to, what sort of person would you like to create?
Oh, I haven't thought about that for a while, but I have done my fair share of casting in college. I don't know. I mean, I've done some bust work and some plaster casts, and I've actually seen people do sectional body castings where, and they didn't use release properly. I've seen horror stories. Yeah.
Oh no. Yeah, I was going to ask about that. I guess, yeah, you would do what, an arm at one time and then do the torso and all of that. But
a lot of people now will use silicone alginate. And so it's very flexible and loose. And so you can, if you get the hair in, it's not too bad. But I remember when people were casting plaster of Paris, and either you have to shave or use lots of petroleum jelly or things get stuck. And I remember this one guy who was still kind of new, and he was casting a girl, and you have to get the scissors out and start cutting hair because it gets stuck in the cast. And so I've seen that happen. But no, as far as what I would cast, I don't know. Maybe some important figure, because death masks have their place in history, as we can see what people actually look like. I have to think about that one, Jenny.
Cool.
I remember the other night when we were looking at her, and I kept going back and looking at different angles, and it seemed like she was moving. It was kind of eerie almost.
Was that the night of the open bar? So, Tory, when you're saying casting, so is it like in the pictures where they have to put like straws in your nose because they're casting over your face?
Yeah, if you're doing the face, yeah, you would have to put, you don't have to put nose. I mean, depending on how runny the material is, you can actually just kind of go around the nose. But if you put the straws up your nose, then you're definitely going to have, a space to breathe through. But no, yeah. And that's normally done in sections that you might do the front of the face and then the back, and then you'd have a mark, and then the torso and then the arms and then maybe the leg and the hip at one point. So you do them in interesting in sections, and the Hanson ones are interesting because they are posed, so you have to cast them in that pose.
And once the cast is set, once it's used once, is it not usable again if you wanted to make a duplicate?
It depends on the process. So a lot of starting or older casts would do plaster. And so you do a negative and then you get a positive. And if you're only going to do that positive, the negative gets destroyed. You chip it off. And so then you just have the positive. But a lot of new casting with alginate, you'll put that on, and then you reinforce that with plaster, and then you can make multiple positives. So it depends on the material. With plaster casting, sometimes you only do get one pull. So you would just do one mold and then do a positive. I do not, when you're casting for multiples, and I do know artists that get contracted to make works for other people, they'll do a plaster negative, then they do a plaster positive, and that becomes a master. So you take that master and then you make more cast off that instead of casting from the original. But as far as Hanson, I believe he only did, he just one off. So he probably destroyed the molds when he was done. I don't know for sure, but that's really likely because you end up with lots of material. So maybe we'll do plaster casting sometime.
Oh no, okay, I think gonna drink next year. Everybody come in and we'll cast an arm, right? Very interesting. Yeah, I wonder what his process was too in choosing. I know you said, obviously secretary was his secretary, and his children also were models, but I'm curious too what his thought process was in choosing certain folks as his,
Well, he was only in New York for a few years. So most of the work is from Florida. So those models have to be, probably from his home in Florida. But for those few years that he was in New York, New York models. And so,
yeah,
who knows, maybe Greta really was a secretary, or maybe she was a model. She's quite thin. And she's roughly about 5'8", I estimate.
But no age spots.
Makeup. But there's veins.
Perfect fiberglass skin. I noticed with the glasses, did you just clean those or were those replacements?
Those are clean. They were actually a little small for the temples are spread out, but because they cleaned up very well, we put them back on. They're actually tied on to the back of her head so they don't come off. But yeah, they were caked with dust. They hadn't been removed for quite some time.
Are they prescription?
Yes. And they actually had an anti-glare film on them. So that's why I didn't polish them. I just cleaned them and they're kind of intact, yeah.
Wow, that's amazing.
So the temples are spread out.
Very cool. Well, do we have any further questions for Tory or? Has everybody gone and seen the secretary in person? Have we all? Great, wonderful. Well, I just want to thank Tory again for that great presentation. It's super entertaining, a lot of fun facts. Thank you again so much. And then just a reminder, next month will be Wooden Waves. So Roxanne and Matt Ortiz will talk about the mural that is behind those vinyl pieces in Kinau Courtyard. So hope you folks can join then and have a good rest of your evening. Thank you so much, folks. All right, take care. Bye.